Happy Sabbath, everybody. Thank you for joining us at North Hills Church today. Please stand as we sing our first song, Draw Me Close to You. Father, please help us to know that you are near to us, Father, that you are here in this place this morning, Father, I ask that if we've come in with any hang-ups, that you're here, Father, to comfort us and to give us your peace and your love, Father. And we just ask that today, as all the events are happening around the world, what's happening in Gaza, what's happening in Israel, Father, we ask that you put your hand out, Father, and you touch those. You touch the afflicted, and you touch those who have been afflicted by war. And you also come into our lives, Father, and you show us the greater life that you have in store for us. And so we just ask, Father, that today, well, we have all these many blessings with us, that you help us, Father, with our hang-ups. You help us to cure our habits. And you're here, Father, just to remind us that we're loved and that we're your children. And today we give thanks to you. And the songs today are meant as an expression of our thankfulness. And we just ask, Father, that you be with us each and every day. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now turn next to you and give somebody a warm North Hills greeting. Voices above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began.
All the women
above all. There's no way to measure what you're. like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Crucified, laid behind the stone. You lived to die, rejected and alone. Like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me.
Drive the nails in my hands, laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead and say it isn't me. The day will come when you will see, 'cause I'll rise again. My love for you is still the same. Go ahead and bury me, but very soon I will be free, 'cause I'll rise again. No power on earth can tie me down, 'cause I'll rise again. And death can't keep me in the ground. head and say I'm dead and gone, but you will see that you were wrong. Go ahead and try to hide the sun, but all will see that I'm the one. 'Cause I'll come again. Ain't no power on earth can keep me back. 'Cause I'll come again. I'll come to take my people back. 'Cause I'll come.
Surrender all.
Thank you for joining us this morning.
Each one of you here. Pastor Tim and Pastor Angel are away on a pastoral retreat this weekend, and we are very happy to have Dr. Karen Cress presenting today. John and Karen Cress are a pastoral couple with rich pastoral experience and administrative experience and scholarship. This is one of those families where I'd like to be a fly on the wall when John and Karen and Tim and Danielle are just kind of hanging out and talking about stuff, about church and so on. I'd just love to be a fly on the wall and listen to that stuff. Karen is sharing with us today. We welcome you here.
I'm afraid that fly on the wall would be more about Seattle Seahawks than anything. Oh, it's good to be here. It's been a while since John and I wandered this direction. John has a new name. It used to be, you know, when the kids were little, they nicknamed him the Fossil. And No. It was, first of all, it was Grumpy Smurf. And then they got into college, and Glenn, who leads music here sometimes, and Tim and all of their gang decided he was the Fossil. So now on lots of things, he's Fossil Cress. But as of about 6 weeks ago, Tim took his dad to play pickleball and discovered that his feet are bigger than his legs and fell. and tripped over his feet or something. I wasn't there, I don't know. Wrecked his hip, and we're still trying to figure out what's happening with that. So we now call him the Canaanator because of that. He loves to use it as a weapon. So, yeah, I talked to Tim this morning. He and the pastors of the LA Metro region, which is one of the five regions in this conference, are on a cruise, actually, testing out whether they really like cruising or not. Tim had never been on a cruise, and the thought of being in a ship, you know, for that long, so they're doing just a short trip. They'll be back Monday. But he called and asked me to do this sermon, and I said, let me think about it, because I have just a few too many other things going on. And then I called back about 2 seconds later and said, Tim, I can't say no to you, so I'll do it. Let me just say, the book of Esther is one of my favorite books, but it's a weird book. Does it belong in the Bible? Does it not belong in the Bible? There are people, scholars, that argue that from both ends, as Tim has pointed out in the past on this book. Esther has no word for God in it, in the book. There's no prayer in the book. There's really nothing spiritual, as we would call it, in the book. But I thought today, one of the ways I look at it is through the lens of a play. Now, one thing you have to know about me, when I was pastoring full-time, I did a lot of music ministry. When I say music ministry, I mean, yes, worship ministry. But on 3 to 4 to 5 times a year, we had these huge plays, musicals, with full orchestra, full choir, full actors, sometimes choreography. I mean, we did it up. And so I prefer looking at Esther like a play in 10 acts, A-C-T-S. 10 acts, as you can read up on the screen. Today, we're going to look at Acts 6 and 7, which is actually chapters 7 and 8, not quite all of 8, because of the way it breaks up. Whoever did the chaptering and versing of the Bible, we need to have questions with when we get to heaven. The Jewish Talmud indicates that Mordecai, the cousin of Esther, wrote this book. And it is a very linguistic book. If you love language, then you love the book of Esther. If you love writing, you love the book of Esther, because the way it's written is so powerful. But to really get to the depths of it, to me, my doctorate was a lot about culture. Usually organizational culture, but culture of any kind really interests me because it affects how we see the world. It affects how we see ourselves within the world. And one of the problems we have as Christians is we keep reading the Bible as if it is our world today, when it would be helpful if we step back and see what was the audience that first read this book. What were they seeing? And so I thought I would start this, before we get into the actual text, I'd give you a little, hopefully fast, primer on the culture of Esther's day. It actually is a culture that is the foundation to all culture worldwide, because all culture began in the Middle East. And all culture is what they call a culture of honor and shame. Honor and shame is a term that they use for it. I don't like the word shame, so I use the word either disgrace or dishonor, but it's all the same. It's the opposite of honor. And honor is, it was the glue that held the society together. But as we dig into this, one of the definitions I like is a person born into the culture of that day was led from childhood to seek honor and avoid disgrace. So from kids, little kids, babies, they were taught very young to seek honor. And we're going to look more into what in the world is that? To seek honor and avoid disgrace. Honor and disgrace is the affirmation of a person's worth. Now today we'd read that and we'd say, how much money do you have in the bank? Right? What is your economic value? But in this day, it was different. What is the worth by peers and society? How do your peers view you and society view you? Awarded based on the individual's ability to embody the virtues and attributes of the social society's values. What are values? Values are our behavior that tells the rest of the world what's most important to us. So what was most important? There's two ways that you could get honor. One was ascribed honor. You were born into it. In this story, the king had ascribed honor because he was born into being king. King Ahasuerus or Artaxerxes or Xerxes or whichever one of those names you like. It's the same person. The other way is acquired honor. Now, acquired honor came from virtues such as piety, courage, reliability, and they could be earned through appropriate behavior. Now, today we look at that and say, that is absolutely insane. How do you attach money to those values? You don't. It had nothing to do with money, even though we like to read it and see it as our view. So for men, there was a double standard, and for women. The male-female thing was a double standard big time. It is part of the world, the ancient world. And by the way, in case you hadn't noticed, it's still a part of the world. The values of honor, male, they looked for piety, unity, agreement, courage, reliability, and above all, loyalty. If that is what, those are some of the major values that would give someone an indication of how much honor you had. It could be ascribed or it could be acquired. Females' honor came from their modesty, chastity, and above all, again, loyalty. So when you look at the book of Esther, we have to look at honor. Those who failed to conform with honored were censured. Should we talk Haman? Huh? We're going to get more into that. The threat of dishonor, what supported the society's prohibition of socially disruptive behaviors. So today, to see if they, if this world stepped into our world today and saw riots going on, they would think we had completely lost our mind and that the whole world ought to be, you know, given the Haman treatment. It just was not okay. You don't act that way. Okay? The most sought after honorable values were what they were looking for in other people and, even more importantly, in themselves, because they had to honor themselves. So that created what is called the patron-client relationship. Now, a patron is a giver. A client is a receiver. That's the easy way to put it. The giver, receiver, and then very often there was a broker or a mediator put into that relationship. They called this the paternal society of honor and shame. The paternal society was the practice that constitutes the chief bond of human society, supported by an infrastructure of networks of favor and loyalty. So what can I do for you, and what you do for me is not the same. So what they would do is if a giver, had property, for instance, a receiver, a client, could take that property, if it was given to them, and develop that property and show loyalty to the patron by developing that property in many different ways, for instance. So the Mediterranean world of that day was so anchored in this society of paternal client-broker relationships that it was the practice that constituted the chief bond of human society. What is the chief bond today? A lot of people say it's economics, it's money, it's bank accounts, but it's more than that. What is the chief bond today? It is still our values. What are our values? That's why it is so incredibly important as an organization such as a church to know, what is it we value? As a couple, what is it we value? One of the very most important, and this is where Dennis would love this, one of the very most important values in our house, including Tim's house, is fun. If it's not fun, it doesn't happen. That means I get to do all the cleaning because that's not fun. So, all right, moving on. The point of the patron-client relationship was not an even exchange of favor, but of an ongoing exchange, something that kept going on and on and on. All right? This reminds me, I don't know if you're into the Big Bang Theory, the series that was on television for forever. It's no longer there, but you can find it almost anywhere. I remember one episode when, who's the smart guy? Sheldon. Sheldon was given a gift for Christmas, and he did not know what to do because he had to find another gift that equaled that gift, but he didn't know how much the first gift that he got cost. So he didn't know how much he needed to give to whoever gave it to him. So it gets into this, it's hilarious, But it gets into, you know, he ends up buying the whole store out and just giving lots of things so that he didn't have to. So one of those would be enough. In the patron-client relationship, there was no even exchange. It was an ongoing exchange. So it wasn't so much what was the value of each, but did you consistently give and receive from one another? And remember, this is a network. It's not just one-to-one. It's a whole network of society. So in this little town of Susa, where the story of Queen Esther takes place, it's within that whole town are all kinds of networks going on. The point was not an even exchange, but ongoing exchange. In such society, gratitude becomes an essential virtue, while ingratitude becomes the cardinal sin of cardinal social and political sin. Let me explain. Where does gratitude come in? Because when you look at the mutual bonds of favor, the way that they calculated how well you knew how to pay favor was through gratitude. Gratitude became the essential glue that maintained social cohesion. If there was no gratitude, you were ostracized. You were kicked out of the club. You were sent out of town, or in Haman's case, otherwise. In such society, gratitude becomes an essential virtue, and ingratitude that cardinal social and political sin. So looking back, we have to go back to the first of the book, to Vashti, Queen Vashti. What was her cardinal sin? A lot of people put all kinds of things to it. When I read it, I see the social sin of Vashti. She was not grateful. She did not show gratefulness to King Ahasuerus when he invited her to come to where the men were, which was forbidden. She did not show appropriate gratitude. And thus she was, I told Tim, I'm going to call it dequeened. He said, well, you can just say she was killed. I said, well, I like dequeened better. She was removed from her position permanently. Gratitude was the glue of favor and exchange in the patron-client relationship and in society of Esther's time. And actually, this goes into New Testament time. And if you really want to say, if you really look at it, there are still pieces of this in the Middle East today. We're going through a war based on this. Gratitude and exchange. Moving on. Gratitude is also the word charis in the Bible, C-H-A-R-I-S, translated as grace. Now, when you look at gratitude and grace, and in the Old Testament, it was one. When you showed gratitude, you were giving grace to another person. So the term that was essential, it was important, and there are three ways that you could interpret that. The giver had a favorable disposition toward the client, the patron-client relationship, so the giver-receiver. The giver had an attitude of grace or gratitude toward the client. The second way is that there was an actual gift bestowed. Sometimes that was land, houses, jobs, all kinds of different things. Sometimes it was fabric or food or all, you know, there's just like today, but rarely coin, okay? The coin was reserved for the king, for his exchange. The third meaning is actually the opposite of the first, where it's the giver finding favor in the client, in the receiver, but it's the receiver showing appropriate gratitude or grace toward the giver. So it's vice versa. Any one of those three ways are the ways charis, gratitude, favor was shown. All right? Hopefully that helps us understand. A person who receives grace and new grace must return grace. All right? And I'm not saying a blessing or a prayer. When I say grace, I mean gratitude. Remember, the word are the same at this point in history. So gratitude had to, if you received something, you had to show gratitude. The best, this is probably the most important thing you can remember today. The best credit rating, today it's a bank account, but the best credit rating one could have in the ancient world was a reputation for knowing how to show gratitude. Wow. That would be, you know, how would we all do with that kind of a credit rating service? Would we be able to stand up? How would our credit rating give us the ability to find help when we needed it? Because if you had a bad credit rating, you couldn't find the help when you needed it. A client who showed disregard for a patron, a giver-receiver, would exchange favor for wrath. So if you did not show enough gratitude or appropriate gratitude, you were disgraced or shown anger, wrath. The gratitude or grace involved intense personal loyalty. Vashti did not show loyalty to the king. So gratitude or grace involved intense personal loyalty to the patron, even if the loyalty led to the client losing their life. That's the shortcut version of that last sentence. The greater the benefit, the greater the gratitude had to be shown. So let's look at Esther 7 and 8. Acts 6 and 7 in a play. Esther 7 and 8. Now, Pastor Angel last week left us hanging. One of the things I told Tim about this sermon series that he's doing is every sermon has ended with a cliffhanger. What happens next? Well, you either have to read the book or come back next week to find out. And next week, just reading the book, let me give you a little hint. Tim will like this because I've given him a bit of his sermon for next week. There are some surprises that are ongoing from chapters 9 and 10 that you will be surprised at. So you'll have to come back next week and hear Tim. Esther 7 begins, well, Pastor Angel left us last week saying that she invited the king and Haman to another banquet. Now, just so you know, there are 10 banquets in the book of Esther that tie the whole book together. It's in a chiastic form, so one banquet is against another banquet at the end. You know, chiastic is a mirror of each other in different ways, usually opposites, because when you look in the mirror, you don't see yourself as you are. You see the opposite of yourself, right? So a chiastic structure does that in simple terms. So last week, Esther had invited the king and Haman. Did they show up? Well, we all know, if you've read or if you've listened or done the cartoon series, we know Haman and the king showed up at this next banquet. One of the interesting things that you have to notice here, on the second day of the banquet, as they were drinking wine for the feast, the king said to Esther, notice, the king said to Esther, not Queen Esther, but Esther. All up until this point, it has only been Esther. From this point on, it turns into Queen Esther. What is your wish, Queen Esther? It shall be granted to you. And what is your request? Even to the half of my kingdom, it shall be fulfilled. Now think of honor, the honor and shame, the patron-client relationship. This is where the honor, he is showing her honor by offering her half of his kingdom. This is the first time he has asked her the same question before. This is the first time he's offering her half of his kingdom. That is a huge patron-client action. As the king is giving or offering Esther half of his kingdom. The other thing about this that you may or may not care about is that the verbs used change from the first banquet to this. The verbs in the first were masculine, this time they're feminine, indicating a more personal attachment. So some time has passed since that first banquet, and during that time, the king has become more and more fond, possibly, of Esther. So we find Queen Esther answering. Then in the next text, the Queen Esther, again, Queen Esther, answered, "If I have found favor in your sight, O king, and if it please the king, let my life be granted me for my wish and my people for my request." Now, those of you who know me at all know that I'm a strengths coach from Gallup. And as I read this, two things hit my mind. Number one, this girl has got the gift of communication. Her strength is knowing how to put together a sentence that will grab attention. And this is an amazing way of approaching the king. She honors him, she shows loyalty to the king, and she is modest to the king. If, not you have to show me, but if I have found favor, if it please the king, she is honoring him with his own feelings, with his own honor. She's sensitive, has a sensitive ear, and a wise heart. God is ready to move forward. She knows when God is ready to move forward, even though everything around her may say, wait. See, there's no such luck, no such thing in our lives as luck or coincidence in my book. It's always God. God is always trying to use whatever our circumstances are. These are some really bad circumstances, right? Esther's people and Esther are set up to be killed, and the king has no clue. Talk about Mr. Clueless. Esther knows her life is more significant to the king than her people's life, so she puts herself first. Let my life be granted, comes before my people. Now, he has no idea who that is. He has no idea what is going on. He's like, what? Who wants to kill a queen? So the next part of her statement is a masterpiece in diplomacy. She sets the stage to accuse Haman without accusing the king. Now think about it. That's a trick. Because the king had given permission to Mr. Haman over here to do whatever he wanted to do. So the king is really partly at fault, but she doesn't bring that up. Why? Because of that honor and shame. She was loyal to the king and knew how to communicate with truth that would honor him and not Haman. So the next verse, "For we have been sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be killed, and to be annihilated." Those are exact words, by the way, from the first edict that Haman had written. That's an exact quote. If we had been sold merely as slaves, men and women, I would have been silent, for our affliction is not to be compared with the loss to the king. Again, look at this through the honor society, the honor of that world. For we have been sold. To be sold was okay. Being a slave was okay. They would look at our world as all of us are slaves if we are getting paid by somebody else. In that world, being a slave was an okay thing to do. Being killed, not so much. Okay? So being sold would have been okay. So she honors the king. We have been sold. She quotes the original edict. He doesn't even get it. The Jews were sold for destruction. It could be, when she says they were sold, they could be sold for destruction. They could be sold because Haman actually offered money to the king to do this thing. So in that way, there was a money transfer. Or the king had been sold a bill of goods, which is also true. So any one of those things could have been true about that sold, that word sold. But Esther goes further. Even sale into slavery would have been sufficiently tolerable to have prevented her from bringing this up to the king. Why? Because it would not have dishonored the king had she and her people been sold into slavery. All right? Very important to notice that, because the rest of this becomes more, it's hard to understand from our world. We don't get that kind of culture because we don't live in that kind of culture, especially here in America. The literal translation of the last phrase, there is no adversity that is equivalent to damage to the king. She was so loyal to hold up the king's reputation, to hold up the king's honor, that she would do nothing to damage the king's honor. Wow. Kind of changes how you read the book, right? The next part, the next verse, verse 5, is interesting to me because in most translations, they leave out words from the original Hebrew. The original Hebrew is in parentheses. Then said King Ahasuerus, and he said to Queen Esther. In other words, he's stuttering. He's stumbling all over himself. What? What is going on here? How do you? He doesn't, he has to take a breath to get himself together. Who is he and where is he? Who has dared to do this, Queen Esther? The awkward repetition of said is not to be, it's not a textual error in my book. It is an, it's an emphasis of the king saying, look, I didn't know this. He's stuttering. It's notable the king does not seem to recognize also the language of the decree. He says nothing about the original decree. He doesn't seem to recognize that those three words at the beginning of this interaction that Esther said to him meant anything to him, because he had been negligent in knowing about Haman's activities and that Jewish family was the background of Esther. He is completely dumbfounded. He doesn't know what to say or do. Verse 6. Esther is literally translated, the adversary and enemy is this vile Haman. Now, when I think of a think of honor and shame, the community in which she and Ahasuerus, King Ahasuerus are living is that type of an honor. Why could she so shame? Because Haman deserved it. Part of honor is speaking the truth. And she is speaking the truth to the king in a way the king understands. Okay, this is a terse indictment, a foe, an enemy, this wicked Haman. Then Haman suddenly realizes, oops, I may have gone too far on this one. And he becomes terrified before the king and queen. Now remember, Haman hasn't had a really great day so far. If this was all in one day, or week, or however long it was. First of all, he had to lead his enemy, Mordecai, around to honor Mordecai for saving the king's life. Then his family foretold him that he was going to die. That could not have been a good news to him. And now this. You would think that Haman would have repented, would have done something, but instead, what does he do? The king, first of all, gets very angry. And I love the way the Hebrew puts this, is that the king is so infuriated that he gave a dramatic, enraged exit out the door to, out the patio door, as I see it, to the palace garden. And the king arose in his wrath from the wine drinking, which probably didn't help the wrath, and went into the palace garden. But Haman stayed to beg for his life from Queen Esther, for he saw that harm was determined against him by the king. Oops. A bit too late. So what does he do? Now, to me, in a honor and shame society, one of the things you have to do then is honor. He doesn't do that. The next verse. And the king returned from the palace garden to the place where they were drinking wine as Haman was falling on the couch. What are the virtues? What are the values looked for in females in an honor society? Modesty, chastity. This does not look like that. All right? Where Esther and the king said, "Will he even assault the queen in my presence, in my own house?" And as the words left his mouth, they, meaning the people that worked for him, they covered Haman's face. Why? Because of the shame. They didn't want anybody to see that face again. To violate the queen was equivalent to tyranny. It was, I mean, you can read about it in all kinds of places in the Bible. And so Haman was placed on a 50 cubit, that's 75 feet high. I don't know how many stories that is, but that's more than one story. 75 feet tall gallows that he had built to hang Mordecai on. Instead, he finds the end of his life there. There not a lot is said about how his life ended. A lot was just passed over. So let's turn to chapter 8. What happened next? On that day, the day of the execution, King Ahasuerus, we think, King Ahasuerus gave to Queen Esther the house of Haman. Now, when you say it, the house of Haman, today we see a structure with a roof and a garage, maybe, and maybe some property, maybe a few horses. In this day, the house of Haman meant everything in the house. The wives, the kids, the servants, the all of the properties, anything that was under Haman's control is now Esther's. He gave to the queen Esther, house of Haman, the enemy of the Jew. He keeps repeating all throughout, when after this point, anytime Haman's name is said, it is said the enemy of the Jew. Just to reiterate, and Mordecai came before the king, for Esther had told him what he was to her, not just a cousin, not just the broker in the three patron-client broker relationship, because he's the one that had coordinated, mediated the relationship to get Esther into even the harem of the king. So Mordecai came before the king. That is a special honor very few people got to do. For Esther had told the king what he was to her cousin. And that the whole issue of kinship, by the way, is huge here. I'm not going to go into that today, but if you want to start studying something, study kinship. And the king took off his signature ring, which he had taken from Haman. We don't know when, where, or how, but obviously before Haman was dead, and gave it to Mordecai. And Esther set Mordecai over the house of Haman. This verse, two verses actually, reek of honor. They reek of that patron-client relationship, broker relationship, of showing favor and loyalty for what they've done. But Esther is not satisfied. So the next verse, Esther spoke again to the king. She fell at his feet and wept and pleaded with him to avert the evil plan of Haman, the Agagite, and the plot that he had devised against the Jews. When the king held out the golden scepter, then Esther rose and stood before the king. There's a couple of important things to note here. First of all is the posture of Esther. The first time she went before the king, she was at a distance. She didn't even walk in the room until the king held out that golden scepter. This time she comes into the room and falls at his feet in tears. Now, my son says that's not fair because a woman in tears always melts a guy's heart. Unless it's a child, that's even worse. But I say, you know, she has to get her point across. And she is heartbroken because her people are still on the chopping block. So far, this king only cared about himself. He doesn't care about what's happening to the Jews. He only cared that his honor was kept. But what about Esther's honor? What about the Jewish honor? So there is a different posture. Again, though, the king holds out that golden scepter because she had honored him and he had honored her. Now, the next verses are so interesting. She said, remember the ifs of the previous a little while ago, verses. If it pleased the king, and if I found favor in his sight, and a third if this time, and if the thing seems right before the king, and I am pleasing in his eyes, let an order be written to revoke the letters devised by Haman the Agagite, the son of the Ham, of whoever, which he wrote. I don't like some of these Hebrew names. Which he wrote to destroy the Jews who were all in all the provinces of the king. For now, how can I bear to see the calamity that is coming to my people? Or how can I bear to see the destruction of my kindred? There's a whole lot in this verse. One of them is the fact that it is a four-part formula that she goes with. One, it's duplicated. One is appealing that the king recognize what is good and right. And the other is that the king regard her honor. And it goes back and forth and back and forth. And in order to get his attention and to understand, so he would do something other than worry about himself. Okay? Those carefully chosen words also get the king off the hook because she completely blames Haman, that evil Agagite. See, I can't speak. So in verse 6 again, there's two parallel expressions. The plea for her people in general, but then she goes even further and to her kindred in specific. Kindred is family. Family was the most important bond there was in that society. And even the bond of kindred was of honor and not shame or disgrace. Moving on, the king Ahasuerus, in verse 7 and 8, said to King Esther and to Mordecai the Jew, "Behold, I have given Esther the house of Haman, and they have hanged him on the gallows." I picture Haman a little bit, I mean, not Haman, King Ahasuerus. I picture him just a little bit ticked at this point. Because, look, I've given Esther the house of Haman. They have hanged him on the gallows because he intended to lay hands on the Jews. But, you know, if that's not enough, then you write what you please. He, again, just like he did with Haman, and just like he does every single time, he pushes it off on somebody else to do. "You write what you please in regards to the Jews in the name of the king and seal it with the king's ring, for an edict written in the name of the king and seal with the king's ring cannot be revoked." That is, right there is the whole problem of the entire book. Haman wrote that first edict. It cannot be revoked. Read the book of Daniel if you don't believe me. In the book of Daniel, there's multiple times throughout where it talks about an irrevocable edict, decree, that cannot be unbroken. And so Queen Esther and Mordecai sit down with the scribes and write a new decree that would not completely undo the first decree, but it was a mirror image. See, the first decree did not name the Jews as addressees. In other words, the Jews weren't notified that they were going to be annihilated. Only the noble, the titles, were notified that the Jews would be annihilated on this certain day. When they rewrote this, when they wrote this new second edict, the Jews are the ones named. Giving them notice that you get to do this. You get to defend yourself. Not only do you get to defend yourself, but if you take out someone else, you can take their possessions. And you have to come back next week to find out what happened with that. Trying to help my son. So as the scribes write this second, the other thing to me that is very, very noticeable on this is that this second decree was written 70 days after the first decree. Why is that important? Because it reminds the Jews of their return from exile in Egypt. So they could hang on to that promise that as they are returned in Egypt, so they will be returned or saved in Persia. Now, one of the things that's really cool about this story to me is when you understand that the next verses, I'm not going to read all of them at this point, but the next verses talk about the king giving telling runners to take this second decree to all of the country. This is what the area looks like today. You see from Iran to Libya to Turkey to Greece, all of that. This is what the Persian Empire looked like, and it went even further east than this. That white arrow points to Susa, which is basically in Iran today. It is no longer known as that. It's an archaeological dig, I believe. But it is a massive, when you look at, you know, go back here and you see Israel, and that little red dot in Israel is the West Bank. And you can't even see, you can see on mine, if you blow it up, you can see Gaza. But when you go back to this, I mean, it is a huge empire. So what did they do? I love this part of the story because I think it's hilarious. The king gives him his fastest horses. Now today, that would be like giving him his fastest jet or Ferrari or whatever can get them. I mean, that's huge. How do you get across all of that area in a short amount of time? Because remember, Haman had set the date. So they had to stick to that date. But they had to also get the message out to everybody in this kingdom that they could defend themselves. A copy of what was written and issued to in the decree as a decree in every province was published. And what happened, you'll have to come back next week. Sorry. They did go and deliver all of the messages. So to boil it down, what have we learned today? Honor was ascribed or acquired. The king was ascribed his honor. Queen Esther acquired her honor by her actions, by her behavior, by how she remained loyal to the king, even when she didn't need to. The patron-client-broker relationship existed for the purpose of showing honor. So the king-queen broker, the king-queen, Mordecai, existed to show honor. The best credit rating for it was a reputation for knowing how to show gratitude, which is honor. So gratitude was the glue that held the society together. So I want to challenge you. Here are some ways to honor. Oh, okay, we're going to jump to the tech, that one. The talk and the walk. In what ways do you honor others? How do you honor yourself? That's what you can talk about today as you're sitting around lunch. Every day this week, choose one way to honor yourself out of this list that we're going to put up for you. If you have, you can find the walk and talk in the Bible app on your phones. To remind you, but these are ways that Esther honored throughout the book of Esther. She paid a compliment. She treated others with respect. She was patient. She asked questions. She showed compassion. She appreciated differences. She accepted help from the king, and she was open. She listened. All of these are different ways that we can show honor, not only to others, but to ourselves. So as we continue, and as next week, as Tim, let me put the list up again. So, or have you leave the list up. Take out your phone and take a picture of that to remind yourself that you can show honor. Our world doesn't know what honor is anymore. Let me encourage you that as you talk about how do you honor others, how do you honor yourself? It's very important to understand. And then every day this week, choose one of those ways to show honor to yourself or someone else. And then write about it in that journal that Pastor Tim gave you a while back. Let's close with prayer. Father, as we have looked at Esther and Ahasuerus, or Artaxerxes, or whatever, and Mordecai, and Haman, and this story of honor, I just ask that we will be reminded that how we treat one another and how we behave toward one another is what gives honor to one another. May we show gratitude in this week of gratitude, a week of thanksgiving. May we understand what it means to show grace as gratitude. Thank you for being here today. In your name I pray. Amen.
We've really, for a number of weeks, been treasuring this special, beautiful story through the readings of Dr. Angela and Pastor Tim and Angel and Dr. Karen. Thank you. A magnificent story. And we wish you all a wonderful Sabbath today and God's blessing with you. A couple of things to remind you of. We are having, there are a lot of preparations underway for the Christmas musical, and there's a rehearsal right following our worship service today, so the children are involved in that. We're having a rehearsal right in here following the worship service, and then also tomorrow there is a rehearsal as well. This is a special season of celebration and worship, and we are also serving our gift list. There are still some gifts that can be taken out there in the lobby. And when you take one of the names for a gift, you can be sure and leave your name there. Write your name in so that we'll know that you've taken one. We last count, we still had 39 gifts to be taken. So there's plenty of room for us to participate in that. And how are we doing? Is that it for? Okay. So those are the main things. Oh, one other thing. I wanted to let you know the fundraising has begun for the Parsonage program. It's exciting. I love being part of this congregation where people love to participate and love to give. The giving is already well underway toward our fundraising for the Parsonage Fund. All right. God bless you today.
Well, good afternoon. Hello, hello. Testing. Okay. I didn't sound loud, but I guess I am. Oh, there it is. Well, good afternoon, church. And thank you, Jesus and Dr. Karen Cress, for a new and fresh word for our minds and hearts today. I love that there's a bunch of new stuff going on at North Hills. And I'm so excited to tell you about another new one, although they stole my thunder just a little bit a minute ago. I'm Veronica Guerin. This is Cristina Burgos. This is, I'm going blank. I'm so sorry, Monica. Your last name is what got me. Navarro, John Weber, and Steve Hoffman. And not on stage with us today is Zane but he's also part of this committee. And this is your new North Hills Parsonage Committee. All right? Yes, yes, absolutely. So this came about really because in 1972, a group of God's people cast a vision for a new church home. And they pursued that vision, and North Hills was dedicated to God in August of 1980. The church building we enjoy today is a result of nothing more but nothing less than a group of God's people identifying a need, putting their belief into action, and participating sacrificially to bringing it to fruition. The church, or rather, 50 plus years later, some things have changed, but a lot has not. Our commitment to, as the body of Christ, to influence our community towards Jesus and to encourage everyone to receive that blessing is still unwavering. But some things that have changed is the landscape around us. The cost of living in Southern California is about 42% higher than the national average, and the cost of housing in California is about 101% above the national average. And this, my friends, presents our church with a new need. It doesn't come as a surprise to any of us, I don't think, that pastoral staff is amongst the hardest working, but nowhere near the highest compensated professionals, right? And North Hills has recognized that. They see that gap between pastoral compensation and the level of income that's required to secure housing here in Southern California. So a parsonage project has begun here at North Hills, and it's going to provide subsidized housing to our pastors and their families. And the parsonage will be a home for our shepherds, both present and future. And this is an investment way past real estate. This is an investment to retain and potentially attract in the future leaders for our church and give them a fighting chance to secure something in the housing realm in California. Now, Jeremiah 3:15 says, "Then I will give you shepherds after my own heart who will lead you in knowledge and understanding, and they will need somewhere to live." No, just kidding. That last part's not biblical, but it's absolutely true.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. So as Veronica was talking about the new parsonage, it seems to be cutting in and out. We would like to invite you to partner with us to help meet the housing needs for the team that leads us here and their families and that continue to give of themselves, bringing God's vision to North Hills. So we know that, you know, this church is a very giving church. You know, we see it in all of the donations and the programs that we participate in, the Christmas one, the Thanksgiving baskets, and we are all big-hearted individuals here. So we just continue to ask that we demonstrate our love, concern, and encouragement that our leaders and their families by supporting this project that we have begun. On your chairs, everybody has a card, and if you can take a minute to scan the QR card that's up on the screen, I think it was on the screen, there it is, or on the card there, it will take you to our church's parsonage page, website page, and then you can get more information about what it is, what's happening, where we are, and be able to donate. North Hills recognizes how critical the need is, as a result has committed to match the first $100,000 in donations. So for every dollar that is donated, North Hills will match it 100%. And the exciting part is we have received our first couple of donations that total $18,336. So with the church match, we are at, I'm even wearing glasses, $36,672 right now. So if you have any questions or, you know, you're curious more about it, we are the committee. You can ask any one of us more about it. Please do go to the webpage and become familiar, and we ask that you open your hearts again to make a donation, because this is a great need for our pastoral care, not only present, but for future. And as Veronica said, they are hardworking and not the highest paid. So thank you, everybody, for listening to us, and we hope that we can make this need met.
Please stand and sing with us as we worship with our last song.
Darling of heaven crucified.
Blessed Sabbath day. Thank you for joining us today.
Thought of me.